करो। हेलो, वेलकम टू द फिफ्थ लेक्चर ऑन साइट प्लानिंग ई शिक्षण। टुडेज लेक्चर आई विल जस्ट एक्सप्लेन द फ्लो ऑफ द प्रेजेंटेशन फर्स्ट। टुडे वी विल बी डिस्कसिंग फ्यू सस्टेनेबल साइट डिजाइन एस्पेक्ट्स व्हिच शुड एक्चुअली बी देयर इन सस्टेनेबल कम्युनिटी डिजाइन, एंड देन I will go to the certain essentials of site planning, like what should be the site to contents, like the physical connections, the spatial connections, formal connections. In spatial connections, I will show you one video of Anji Reddy Memorial done by Sanjay Mohe. Then we will look at what should be the formal connections, natural and cultural connections, and temporal connections. After the temporal connections, I will show you one more video where I want to stress how the spirit of the place is very important to give the landscape for that particular place, how it should indicate the spirit of the place. I will show you one video on Ground Zero Memorial of 9x11 tragedy, and then we'll come to the what is the meaning of site structure unity, how the site and structure should be in union with each other, you know, and how should they should complement each other. And I will show you three examples of the Italian landscapes of Mughal Gardens and Sanskriti Kendra. I will then end my presentation. Today's presentation will be of 1 hour. Okay. Now, last time I started with certain guidelines for site sustainable site design, in which we looked into detail about ecological site design, in which I explained certain aspects of ecological site design, like how you should promote ecological site design, and we discussed the entire project of Nalanda University, in which how ecological site design was taken care of, you know, by looking into the way the site drains, looking into the water channels of the site, looking into the fact how the water collects, and then the lake was designed, and the library in the center of the lake connecting various buildings. And then, you know, also socially how it was connected with the farmers. So we looked at ecological site design last time. Today I will talk about few aspects of how every design should be should have sustainable concepts, or we will talk about sustainable community design. Now, before discussing sustainable community design, let us understand why we need to have what is the need for sustainable site design. Okay, let me tell you. The need for sustainability is basically because there is a tremendous growth in the population due to rapid rate of urbanization and industrialization in cities. And what is happening because of this rate of urbanization and industrialization? Due to urbanization and industrialization, there is an increase in the population, and due to increase in the population, the natural resources in the city are naturally getting getting affected, and hence affecting the environment, and are getting depleted at a very fast rate. Why? Why are the natural resources getting depleted? Because first of all, we are not really looking at how the natural resources should be taken care of. So they're getting depleted at a very fast rate due to unsustainable practices like haphazard growth, unorganized planning, illegal constructions, encroachment of open spaces in neighborhoods, and thus spoiling the health of the neighborhoods. See, if there are beautiful natural resources in a city, and if you want to do roads in the city, or if you want to widen the roads, we just cut the trees in the city. It's happened with Belgaum. Right now in Belgaum, it has happened. When they wanted to go for road widening, there were age-old, beautiful, you know, 50 to 100-year-old trees which were beautifully giving comfort to the people who are using the road, in vehicular manner as well as pedestrian manner. But what has happened is that for the road widening, they have just gone on removing all the beautiful rain trees, so the tree cover is affected. What happens when the tree cover is affected? When the tree cover is affected, the heat island effect starts, and then thus it is leading to warming the whole places, and thus leading to discomfort of the people who are using these places. So it should be taken care of that you look at natural resources and respect the natural resources. Now, what are the guidelines of such a site design? First, let me define to you what is sustainable site design. Sustainable site design is an integrated process with objectives of harmonizing the natural environment with the built environment. whatever environment you're planning should be harmonized with the natural resources. We should understand what are the vegetation communities of the land. We should understand what are the topography of the land. We should understand what is the hydrology of the land. We should understand what is the climate of the land. And hence design in a manner that the built environment is in sync with the natural environment. The following strategies can contribute in achieving the goals of sustainable site design. Sustainable site design entails ecological site design and sustainable community design. Ecological site design is achieved by promoting biodiversity, preserving and re-establishing landscape patterns, water resource management, conservation and restoration of resources, reinforcing the natural infrastructure, as I've already explained in Nalanda University campus by Vastushilpa Foundation. Now, what is sustainable community design? Sustainable community design, this type of design strategy is oriented towards achieving a comfortable and high quality built environment which is socially, environmentally and economically viable. Sustainable community design should have these three factors mainly. It should be socially viable, it should be environmentally viable and it should be economically viable. Now, how do you make it socially viable? Socially viable in the sense, promote lots of interaction between the occupants. See, if you're designing housing, if you're designing housing, there has to be a lot of open spaces between the housing clusters or between the apartments or between the buildings, so that there is a lot of interaction between the occupants. What is happening recently is lot of the open spaces in the city are also getting diminished. They are getting diminished and new buildings are coming up there. And this is leading to loss of interaction between the between the people occupying the space. And due to loss of interaction, it is getting affected socially. So when we say that sustainable community design, social aspect is one of the main. Socially, we have to promote by having lots of interaction between the occupants, may it be housing design or may it be some other design also. Then it has to be environmentally sustainable. Environmentally sustainable means lots of environment sensitive design, like design materials which are used for the apartments or for the housing, should have low carbon footprint, or they have to be eco-sensitive materials, like maybe bamboo, earth technologies, if you use technologies like ramped up construction, etc. Also, you have to see that you maintain the natural resources of that particular place, maintain the vegetation communities of that particular place, respect the genius loci of that particular place, do cutting and filling to the minimum, or cutting and filling has to be balanced. Excavation has to be to the minimum. Topsoil has to be good. Try to put the ground covers. Okay, so these few factors have to be considered to make it environmentally sustainable. And economically sustainable is the last one. Economically sustainable means use of low cost and sustainable design materials. These are three principles of sustainable community design. Sustainable community design should be socially sustainable, should be environmentally sustainable and economically sustainable. It should include features like walkable neighborhoods. Like you should be a lot of pedestrian things should be encouraged. Pedestrianization should be encouraged, or you should have walkable neighborhoods, as you can see in this particular picture. Also, there has to be mixed land use. You have to have a mixed land use. Commercial, residential should be, you know, mixed together. So you should have mixed land uses. Then they have to be culturally creative. You know, those open spaces, whichever you provide, have to be culturally creative. It should not be boring and banal. Or even the pedestrian spaces which you do, or the streets which you plan, should have a lot of sitting areas, should have a lot of trees. You know, they have to be culturally creative. And healthy outdoor-indoor environment should be there. In the sustainable communities, there has to be a very good blurring of indoor and outdoor, and it should be a healthy outdoor-indoor environment. They have to be socially just, ecologically healthy, physically and economically accessible. These are few of the characteristics of sustainable community design. Now, the other site design characteristics such as design diversity should be there, beauty and aesthetics, communities with a sense of place. The communities which you design should have a sense of place, should have a sense of belonging. People should have a feeling of belonging to that particular community. Then there should be preservation of open spaces. Open spaces should be preserved There has to be a very good balance of open spaces, almost 30 to 40%, and they have to be well designed, they have to be well landscaped, they have to be well shaded, they have to be provided with good paving material. You know, all these aspects should be there in the open spaces. There should be sit outs in the open spaces. Open spaces should foster interaction between the occupants or between the people who are using the neighborhood. Then there has to be variety of transportation. There has to be bicycle routes, there has to be, you know, carpooling routes, there have to be pedestrian routes. So there have to be multiple transportation, variety of transportation routes. People should have an option of, you know, walking or pedestrianization. People should have an option of biking. Okay, there has to be biking trails. People should have an option of, again, reducing the number of cars, so carpooling. So variety, also bus trails should be there. So there have to be varieties of transportation whenever you are having sustainable community design. Then the building designs have to be compact. They have to be compact building design, especially if you should see that the site is used in a very judicious manner. They have to be compact building designs, and open spaces have to be really large and good. And celebrate light in these open spaces. Celebrate light in the building designing of buildings. But respect darkness. These are few aspects which are highly recommended to achieve the targets of sustainable community design. For example, if you see in this picture, you have multiple transportation routes. Like you have the option of walking also. So pedestrianization is also there, and you have option of using the bikes also. Then in between there have to be, you know, such courts where you can park your bikes. So lots of interaction between the occupants is something which is extremely important in sustainable community designs. I will show you 3-4 more pictures. See, in this particular thing, there are beautiful walking routes designed between the communities, and these walking routes are made beautiful by having very good landscaping on either sides, so that you have the pleasure of walking in those spaces. You have the pleasure of meeting people. Now, if you see this particular picture, people are walking very beautifully here in the midst of beautiful landscaped areas, and there are small, you know, farming patterns which are there here. So people can, you know, you should have a pleasure of even having these kind of farming patterns, agricultural patterns in between, grow your own gardens. So these things also should be encouraged in the public spaces as well as in the their own private spaces. So these are also some components of sustainable community design. And environmentally means lot of environment sensitive design. See, the neighborhoods have to be livable. How to make them livable neighborhoods? You should have beautiful streets ending up in chalks. The streets should be landscaped, the street should be shaded, the street should be comfortable to be used. You may have water channels around the sides which may be helping in evaporative cooling. The buildings also have to be aptly shaded so that, you know, it reduces the carbon footprint. So these are few attributes of sustainable community design. Then the kind of material techniques which you use should be environmentally sustainable. For example, I'll just give you one example. Filler slab is one of the low cost technique of construction. So you can use techniques like this. You know, you can use rammed up construction, you can use filler slabs, you can use CSEB bricks, that is compressed stabilized earth blocks, as building material, so which further reduces the carbon footprint. So this is demonstrated in the visitor centers at Auroville. You have used compressed stabilized earth blocks. See, if you have good topsoil or if you have good earth in the surroundings, like I told you in the design of Nalanda campus, the soil from the site or the surrounding areas can be used to manufacture compressed stabilized earth blocks, and these can be used in the construction. So it becomes environmentally sustainable and also it becomes economically viable. Using techniques like these, filler slab constructions also reduces the materials and creates comforts in the interiors. And you can use rammed earth construction techniques, or you can use bamboo, you can use adobe, you can use cob. So these are few building materials and techniques of construction which you can use when you are going for sustainable community design. Now let me come to certain essentials of site planning. See, as of now we have discussed site planning with various schools of thought, where I told you in certain sites how the use factor was important. For example, Falling Waters by Frank Lloyd Wright, you know, the site characteristics were extremely important, and they were used to, you know, really cite the building in such a manner that it was sited on the rock and the falling water and the waters, so that you know site characteristics are enhanced. And we looked at certain other like IIT Kanpur, where you know the use factor was enhanced. Then I also told you how a detailed site analysis is extremely important to understand all the layers, like natural layers, cultural layers, biological layers. Then you know the subcategories of those layers. What are the different layers which we need to understand, like topography, soil, hydrology, flora, fauna, climate, wildlife, vegetation, land use. Okay. Then we also need to understand the attributes of these. Now, what are the attributes of these layers? And then we need to site the buildings. Today, I'm going to discuss to you other essential of site planning, that is site to context connection. Beyond physically siting the buildings, there are other things also which are extremely important, which are called as site to context connections. Are they important? Yes. Site to context connections and connectivity in site design are the most important criteria in site planning. The most tangible part of site planning is the creation of meaningful places. You know, it's not only about understanding the topography, understanding the climate, understanding the flora and fauna, understanding hydrology. Creation of meaningful places, as I will show you a film later by a video by of Anji Reddy Memorial. See, the most tangible part of site planning is the creation of meaningful places, such as in Anji Reddy Memorial by architect Sanjay Mohe, expressing the feel of the person or expressing the feel of the typology which you are discussing is extremely important. Inspiring people and scientists in Anji Reddy Memorial. The entire Anji Reddy Memorial is such a beautiful building composition that it speaks of the person. So what I mean to tell you in this particular layer is that essential of site planning is that it is extremely important to create meaningful places. It's extremely important to create places of visual delight, like wooded connections, pools of water, and spaces having identity, spatial identity. I repeat, the most tangible part of site planning is creation of meaningful places, such as in Anji Reddy Memorial by architect Sanjay Mohe, expressing the feel of the person, inspiring people and scientists, then creating places of visual delight like wooded connections, pools of water, and spatial identity. Now, in creating site to context connections, factors should be need to be considered. For example, now we are looking at plan of IIT Kanpur. In IIT Kanpur, there is a beautiful integration of circulation corridors. See, in creating site to context connections, the following factors need to be considered. The first thing is physical connections. Physical connections in the form of circulation corridors, vegetation patches, or hydrological features need to be encouraged, as they promote larger flow and health of landscape. Now, how do they promote larger flow and health of landscape? I will take the example of IIT Kanpur. In IIT Kanpur, physical connections are not just mere connections, but there is a beautiful integration of the circulation corridors connecting various parts of the campus. There are beautiful vegetation patches at the sides of the corridors and hydrological features like lakes, which are created to create microclimate and also evaporative cooling. And these elements, like the corridors, the beautiful connecting corridors, the beautiful vegetation at the side, the lakes, encourage larger flow of people. See, if the connections are banal or boring between the buildings, people will not be encouraged to, you know, use the connections. So the connections between the buildings, and what I mean to highlight here is physical connections between the buildings should foster or encourage the movement of people between the buildings. Okay, they have to be supported by very good vegetation at the sites. For example, if you have seen in IIM Bangalore, the connection between the buildings are beautiful. There are, you know, beautiful shaded walkways between different buildings of IIM, which are shaded by pergolas on top and having green patches at the side. This was done by B.V. Doshi, the IIM Bangalore I'm talking about. The present plan which you're seeing is of IIT Kanpur. The connections between the various buildings are beautiful, and they are beautiful shaded pathways covered on top, and at the side there will be beautiful vegetation. In between there will be lakes or pools of water to, you know, for evaporative cooling. So all this fosters the connections or encourages the movement of people between the buildings. Okay, and it also encourages larger flow of people, promoting good health of the landscape. Now let me come to the spatial connections. Now we have talked about the physical connections like the corridors. Now let me come to the spatial connections, like how should be the spatial connections. Spatial connections such as how a site may be organized as an open or wooded site to either link with the buildings or contrast with the surroundings. Now what you see in IIM, this is a plan of IIM Ahmedabad. IIM Ahmedabad, the buildings have a very strong vocabulary. The buildings are brick and they have a very strong vocabulary, that is they have very large openings which literally speak to you. And if you see, the open spaces between the buildings or the spatial connections between the buildings are kept open, you know. They are kept open so that you can, you know, visually connect with the buildings as you are using the spaces in between. Okay, so there are two things. You can have open connections to link various buildings and the context, like it is done in IIM Ahmedabad by Louis Carr, and also done in IIM Ahmedabad planned by the new IIM planned by Bimal Patel. Here the spatial connections are kept open so that they have visual links with the building when they are traversing from one place to another. And these spatial connections are sometimes, you know, like if you see in the new IIM, these spatial connections are highlighted by giving some certain sit outs, by good lighting, and by, you know, giving a moderate landscape. For example, even in Louis Kahn, if you see the IIM in Ahmedabad, done by Louis Kahn, the Louis Kahn Plaza, which is the most important, this is one of the most important and beautiful open connection which is there between the building. So, you know, you can visually connect with the building. So there may be an intention of keeping the spatial connections open. Now, I will show you another building where this is the building which is done by Joseph Allen Stein in Delhi, the India Habitat Center, where the Council of Architecture office is housed. Here, the connections between the buildings are open, but they are landscaped, you know, in a beautiful manner to create microclimate, because you know that Delhi is very large. So, if not keep the connections just open, they have to be landscaped. They are to create a microclimate or to create microclimatic conditions or comfort conditions. And also, you can see in this particular image, these connections are further enhanced by beautiful landscape, like, you know, the tall palms which give you a good shade. Here they are tiered, open connections are tiered, and then you have these shrubberies and topiaries to give you the comfort. And here you can see that they are also covered on top by space frame. Now the space frame is also lending a unique character to this open. You know, there are two kinds of connections. I will show you Anjali Memorial. The connections were good. Whereas in IIM Ahmedabad, or done by Louis Kahn, as well as IIM Ahmedabad, done by each other. Or, you know, the vocabulary of the building was so loud with those loud openings, as you can see in IIM Ahmedabad, done by Louis Kahn. So there may be an intention to keep the connections between the building open and moderately landscaped. In Joseph Fallenstein's Council of India Habitat Center, the connections between all the six towers is open, but it is richly landscaped. It is richly landscaped with palms, shrubberies, topiaries to create a microclimate. There were a lot of steps there for the people to sit. So the open connections are richly landscaped with trees, palms, shrubberies, topiaries. There are sittings for people to sit and use those places. There are fountains for people to have visual delight. So this is what I mean, you know, site to context connections should be there in site planning, so that it creates places of visual delight and meaningful space created. Now I will show you the third example, where the connection between the buildings were wooded. Like this is the Anjali Memorial done by Sanjay Mohde, where connections between the various buildings were thick wood connection. The beautiful text used for the building. There may be intention to have these kind of bullet questions. They may be very, very materialistic at some places. They have intention to have still pools of water. The issue of
ಇದು ಲಿಂಕ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಪೇಸ್ಟ್ ಮಾಡ್ಕೊಂಡು
Yes, actually, I wanted to see the video because only through the GDP, the video is not getting. Do you want to continue without seeing the video, or do you want me to continue without seeing the video? Do you want to see the video and continue? Please let me know to the chat. Hello, I want to see the video of Anjali Memorial and you want me to continue? Hello viewers, madam, we will watch the video first for better. Yeah, that is better. Yeah, that is good. Yes, that is good. That is good. Yeah, because the video is very meaningful. It expresses how beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. ते बघणार आपण नव्हतं व्हिडिओ आम्ही वॉच म्हणाल ते हा मोठा स्पेसेस हा एक मिनट चैट घालते हैं करते Hello, are you being able to see the video? I have uploaded the link. Please let me know through the chat. I had actually muted in between so that you can see the video, because seeing the video is extremely important to really understand how bullet connections between the buildings, like bullet connections between the buildings, would really you know, help us create the spirit of the person for whom it was designed, like that is the Anji Reddy Memorial. So can you see it on your, are you being able to see it on your local computers? Then today you see the video, I will continue next time. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Perfect. So. We are watching now. वीडियो खूप सुंदर आहे. एक्शन्स असे ना. थँक यू फॉर द लिंक मॅम. वेरी एन्जॉयिंग. ओके परफेक्ट. आय एम रियली हॅपी. या इट्स एक्झॅक्टली कम्युनिकेटिंग how site context connections is partial ones are important, significant Kent. Contrast between open connections and ones with rich material palette. If chat sagayana diste na. ऑन किया ओके सो आई थिंक आफ्टर सीइंग अंजी रेड्डी मेमोरियल इज एक्सट्रीमली क्लियर टू यू हाउ द कनेक्शंस बिटवीन द बिल्डिंग वर वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट द पाथवे विच अंजी रेड्डी यूज टू यूज फ्रॉम हिज हाउस लेबोरेटरी हाउ दैट वॉज इफ यू रिमेंबर अ स्केच डन बाय मोहे where his laboratory was there and where he used to entertain his guests, you know, and the whole pathway had Ashoka trees. How reliving that particular pathway was extremely important. And Mohit tried to create similar connections in other pathways which were connecting other portions of the buildings too. And these connections were further enhanced by having a very beautiful vocabulary for the walls of the buildings also, external walls, you know. Some of the external walls had beautiful depictions of, you know, material palette in such a manner that it literally creates, you know, a beautiful texture on the buildings. There was a very good contrast between plain textures and the textures which are created by stones, which created a beautiful shadow impact. So it's the connections may not only be between the buildings, it may also be established by the material palette used for the building, also can be beautifully presented. Also, in between there are, you know, beautiful water pools. Shallow water pools, which are reflecting the surrounding environment and thus creating visual delight and thus highlighting, you know, the whole space in a very, very beautiful manner. So this way few, so I think that was the whole reason I wanted you to see the Anji Reddy Memorial video. Now, the next one is the formal connections. Now, what are the formal connections which are there between the buildings should also relate to the regional vernacular materials. For example, this is a building done by Raj Rewal years back. What it indicates is that sometimes the formal connections or the pathways which you're using between the buildings or the shaded walkways which you're using between the buildings also, not always, you know, in Anji Reddy Memorial, it's not possible. But sometimes to, you know, respect the vernacular materials, the vernacular material palette may be used to strengthen the formal connections. Formal connections related to vernacular materials like stone, architecture and natural forms create unity. See, when the material palette belongs to that particular place, it will create a sense of, you know, belonging to that particular place. So this building which was done by Raj Rewal in Delhi, it used the typical palette which belonged to Delhi, the sandstone. The pink and the dark pink sandstone was used. So the material palette was intentionally used to create a sense of place or to respect the vernacular materials between the building, vernacular material of that particular place. Then the next picture which I need to show you is of the Ghats of Banaras. Now, why the Ghats of Banaras are used here? See, natural and cultural connections. Natural and cultural connections, the integration of human and natural forms to function as a regenerative human ecosystem, such as stormwater treatment system through wetlands, is critical expression of connectivity. Now, what I mean to highlight here is that if you see the image of NIFT Delhi, you know, NIFT Delhi, B.V. Doshi is used a central kund, which is actually an expression of the water kunds which were used as cultural expressions. Now, water is one of the most beautiful interface of, you know, like for example, if you see the ghats, you see the kunds. These were the places where people used to collect to gather water, and these were the best socio-cultural places. So actually, he has used these kunds or ghats as a metaphor for the open-air amphitheater which is used in NIFT Delhi. I do not have the image of this. I will try to show you the image next time. I think for today, the presentation is over. The remaining presentation we will see on Monday. It will be a one-hour session where I will continue with my other connections, formal connections, temporal connections, natural and cultural connections. And then we will go to the next topic, that is site structure unity. Why site structure unity is important? Why there has to be unity between the building and the site which you design? Building and the landscape which you design. Okay. Thank you for today. See you on Monday at 11 o'clock. Okay. Yes.